Hello, everybody. Marty McConnell here with another cool episode of My Life in the Woods, I guess. So anyways, I was at the market today selling microgreens. Stop in and buy them if you're in the West Plains area on Saturday. And books. And somebody came in with something I've been looking to get my hands on. This is a scythe blade. And you might be able to tell from the shininess, I kind of just roughed the edge onto it real quick just to do a test cut by hand. Basically just holding it more or less like this and just nice and slow across some grass. And it is cutting. So I got this for $5. I saw it in the back of his truck and I was like, what's that thing? And I noticed it was short, where most of the blades around here were used for cutting grass in the oldie days. So a lot of these blades are like three feet long, darn near, and they're really, really skinny, and they're only really good for cutting grass. This is an example of what you call a ditch blade. It's a little bit heavier blade, which is really not that heavy at all, to be honest. And this is better for brush clearing and things of that nature, which what I need for getting straw from this little hay field over here. And I don't have enough room, really, or enough enthusiasm, and definitely not enough money to get a tractor in there and cut it. And at the same time, even if I did want to play with that old lawnmower and get it working again, the lawnmower is just going to knock the stuff up and turn it into dust. So what I really want, if I want good quality hay, or in my case straw, to mulch my garden and for some other neat little projects we're going to be doing, I need to chop it off at the bottom and then stack it up where I've got long pieces of straw and I can use them for various stuff. So this is something I've been looking for a while. It just happened to show up at the farmer's market today. And when I got it, it was attached to this. Now this is the end of a snath, or at least it was at one point. This wood's all rotted out and chipped up and it looks like hell. But it's obviously been sitting out in the weather. It said something about finding it down by a railroad track or something. I don't know, but I took one look at this and I was like, I'm never gonna get that bolt loose. But then I got it home, put a wrench on it, and just the bolt popped right loose. It didn't even squeak or nothing. It's just, I'm gonna put this down before I injure myself. I got it where it's pretty much, you can turn it by hand to a certain point. Now, I probably still need to get some WD-40 and spray in there and clean this out, but this bolt is kind of important because this doesn't actually hold the snath onto the little head here. I forget what it's called. This rivet does that work, and so I'm gonna have to figure out a way to get that rivet out, but more on that later. What this does is it's got a little loop in one end, and it slides down in here to tighten down, and basically down there, I'm not gonna need it. Set up straight. This guy drops in here. Come on. And then once he's in there, you can rotate around to these little pegs in here and lock him down wherever he needs to be. And then shove that guy down in there, tighten that bolt, and that just secures the blade to the handle. Do I have this on backwards? Yes. No. No, I don't. So basically that's it. And then this whole assembly turns upside down. Now this is going to want to be level with the grass. And you basically just swing your body. And as you swing your body, this thing's coming around you on the end of a long pole and just shearing off the grass. It's coming in at an angle kind of like this. So it's bunching and shearing, kind of like a scissor action almost, but with a single blade to slice the grass off. So as you're doing that, it makes tall grasses cut a little easier. So there are a couple tricks that are going to be involved here with getting this to work. At first I thought, well, maybe I go to a rummage sale and find a snath 2 for $10 and they'll have me a $15 scythe. There are a couple problems with that. Number one is snaths are usually made to fit a specific person. And even though these blades can come in handy, having more of these at different sizes, I don't know. I got home and I got to looking at this and I actually glanced to see if there was a YouTube video on this. I didn't even really watch it, but sure enough, there's a guy making a snath. So snaths can come in a couple of varieties. I think most of us here in America, for whatever reason, think that curly American snaths are the way to go. But the British idea of a snath, or the European idea, I should say, is actually a straight handle that's got an arm mounted to it that you can grab onto for a grip that's separated from the blade on the lower part, so it doesn't have to have that weird, wicked-looking bow in it and then bow back the other way down here. I don't know anything about steam bending wood, so that idea for me making one personally is kind of out until I acquire more knowledge or come up with the money to buy a custom snath or whatever. So that idea is kind of out. So instead, I found this. I made a new T-post for my clothesline that I planted out in front of the house yesterday, and I cut it from a piece of walnut that was just, it was a tree that was growing kind of scraggly anyways, and I was like, well, that's good enough to make a post to hang clothes on. So I'll just go ahead and use that. This is never going to be a $10,000 tree, no matter what I did. I mean, you take one look at it, no, it's never going to be a expensive tree or a high quality tree. Walnut's not especially good for burning or anything else, but I think in this case, at least for a little while, I can get away with this and use this as a test blank to do this. So the one part of the video I did pay attention to is those guys said something about the height being a hand grip taller than you. So this is also already cut to about the perfect length. Now that, unfortunately, is going to get my handhold moved back even further because this end has a problem. Ooh. So we've got a little flare on this end, which I'm thinking about using to my advantage. So I can basically hang this lower, put a taller handle on it, and then I should be able to get that blade, even though it's got a wedge on it, this is still going to need to be aligned to where when you're holding this thing, that wedge is, it's going to be holding the blade parallel to the ground. Okay, so some fitting is going to be necessary at some point, but I think, at least, and I could be totally wrong on this, and like I said, this is just going to be an experiment, because this is free. I mean, this found a chunk of wood out in the forest, and I want to use it for something. So, I think that will give me an advantage where I'll have to cut less of a wedge on this side, and I can kind of fine-tune it from where it already is. Or if it does end up being a problem, I can always lower the angle because this end's nice and fat. So we're just going to start out, see how everything sort of fits together, and go from there. But the first step is going to be to get this big, knotty, gnarly craziness off the end of this here and just go ahead and shave the bark off, see what we're working with underneath here. I've already stripped off a couple of these little more branches were coming out. So for that, there's a little chopping axe and I'm gonna go ahead and get to work. And then I'm probably not gonna do this all in one take. This is not gonna be a one take video by any stretch of the imagination, but I'm basically just gonna peel the bark off of here and cut that end off. And this, in case you didn't notice, is the wonderful hatchet that I've been fixing for a while. It's my first hatchet handle. And getting the handles right is gonna take me a minute, and it's gonna take some time, and I'm gonna have to figure out a plan for that before I actually start attacking this. So instead of doing a straight one through one and done cut video, I I'm going to shave this down and then turn off the camera. And whenever I come back to this project, if it's later today, later this week, next month, doesn't matter, then I will add to the video. And eventually, hopefully, I'll turn this guy into a snath and we can get mowing and cut some of that straw and stack it up and bale it. And then we can start making cool stuff out of it, because making stuff is cool and fun and interesting. Skinning with a hatchet. I normally actually use a machete for this kind of thing, but lately I've been using these little axes and hatchets for just about every little chore around here, just because, I mean, this may look like a lot of work, but this is taking zero energy on my part. And you can see I'm in a shaded area today. I'm actually out in the pole barn, because as soon as the sun came out today, it just felt like it was about 30 degrees hotter. So I was like, man, I'm not working in direct sunlight because I'll sweat like a pig. But yeah, just hacking away with these and see where it gets going. So get ready for the fast forward now. Kind of wandered off camera there a little bit. So now I'm just going to, you're probably not going to see this part because I can't even see my foot, but I'm basically just going to knock this little head off. And I got a beam here that I'm working on. I'll probably just do it that way. So ready to go. Basically using the same theory that you would use to fell a tree. That way I can get kind of a half flattened angle down here on the end. I don't have a big bulge. As you can see, my aim still leaves something to be desired. But that's why we do stuff like this. Get a little better each time. So now I'm going to whack at it from the other side and knock that little, the rest of that piece off. Again, going slow, taking my time. It's not hard. I'm not really breathing heavy. I'm getting a little thirsty, but that happens. Ba-doom, we're done. So now I've got a measurement on the height of this thing. Ba-doom, ba-doom, ba-doom. Ba-doom. And yeah, that's pretty much There's one hand hold above. I don't think I need to mark that because it's pretty much marked. I'm just going to go ahead and take some of this rough stuff off this edge. And there's a little crack up here, which is going to become a problem, but this is not an ideal piece of wood. So what are you going to do? I think that'll be good enough. So, yeah, I got a handle on this. Should be, I think, just about the right size. You didn't see nothing. And my handle appears to be staying on this time. So, totally awesome. And I think that'll be it for this part of the video. Now I'm going to get me a drink of water and find something else to do for today while I think about how I'm gonna get that thing hafted onto this thing and how we're gonna do these handles and handholds and all this other stuff. So until next time, well, the video is not over yet, so I will see you in a minute, day, week, however long it takes. Catch you in a few. I swear I'm the king of chopping my own head off and camera set up, but I don't have a little dealy bob for the top of my camera mount anymore. I don't know where it went or what happened to it. So we are going to do a little close up here. So this is what this came off of. And as you can see, well, maybe you can't, I don't know. There's a little metal rivet right here that goes all the way through. And I basically just took a hacksaw and sheared that sucker off. It took me like 5 minutes. Hardly noteworthy. Now this is basically the design that we're working with. Now, you can see there's a wedge here that the blade mounts to this so that it's flat with the ground. So ideally we want about that bevel on our thing. So this is going to be sitting like this on the ground. And we should be able to adjust the cant angle of our stick very easily. Now I looked at this, the dimensions on this thing are pretty close width-wise to the end of my log. So I think I may have just lucked out on that one and picked a log that was just barely big enough. We'll see how that shapes up. So what we got to do now is scrape down the top of the log and make a profile for this. And then we need to figure out a wedge angle, and I'm just going to try and get it close. So I'm basically going to set the log down and next to this, holding it with my left hand extended. And we'll see how close we are to this. And that'll tell me if I need to take some wedge out or not. And then I'll go ahead and refit it. But for now, I just want to waste some wood, trim the end of our log piece down to match this. And we're going to be using this to do it. Again, Mr. Hatchet comes in handy for everything lately, doesn't it? Okay. Find our stick. And I also noticed that this has got a natural bend to it. And I looked, and I'm going to be holding it in my left hand like this, and then I'm going to have some kind of grip over here. Now, in addition to being bent up, that's naturally going to bow the board down where that sweet spot is. but there's also a little flex back in it, kind of like this, which I think can be solved by using these guys, but from all the pictures I've seen, there's always that slight backward thing, and that brings the blade out so it can like grab more grass. And then if you need to correct that by tuning the blade in a little bit, you just move it to a different notch on here, and that will reset that angle later on. But if I hold it like this, I've got a clear top and a clear bottom, and I can kind of see where they're at on that wedge. And it looks like my wedge angle is going to be pretty darn close. So I'm just going to start on the top here. And I'm going to remove some material. Now the easy way to do this is to make some cuts going like this, and then you can kind of shave that guy down from there. So it's just like using a chisel, except faster, and probably slightly less accurate. And I'm just going to measure this up here, and that looks like that'll work for a top. So I'm going to get on the bottom the same way, but first I'm going to make sure that's actually the true top that I'm looking at, and it looks like it is. And so now we'll go here and we'll do the same with the bottom. Now I've got this guy as a template, so I know roughly how wide this needs to be. I'm just going to cut it a little bigger than that. And try and keep it sort of half-ass square. Just gonna go ahead and shave this top piece back a bit, so I've got a nice flat leading edge, fairly flat. Now, one thing I've learned about hatcheting is you need an angle to make it work, so you're always going to be chopping in at an angle. But if you heft up on your grip a little, as opposed to back here, you just go right up here near the tool, then you can hit it very lightly and you can make smaller cutouts. So to make smaller cutouts with a machete, normally I angle the machete back a little bit, it's sharper and it's got a tighter bite. The hatchet, that only works so far. So you still need to have an angle on it when you're cutting. So the way to get a thinner cut is just to haft up on it right here near the head, or even just put two fingers up here on the blade. In the case of carving like small wedges to go in the end of these. And then you can just kind of shave it off as long as the bit's sharp, which this one has been doing a little bit of cutting for the last couple days. It's not the sharpest hatchet in the toolbox, and I am just doing nothing except making little wood shavings. So knock that off for a second and we'll test this, see how big it is. And I've got kind of an odd shape here, so I really need to angle this cut back. And kind of flatten that guy out a little bit, like so. And that looks pretty straight. Now the top, I need to do the same thing with it. Just kind of flatten this bottom because it's kind of flared a little bit, so. Basically just wedge it down to take some of that flare out. Now, I'm not concerned with making this super pretty. I have no time or tolerance for pretty. I just need a tool to work. And tools don't have to be pretty to work, I have found out. So that looks like that'll work on top and bottom. It's maybe a little bit off on this side, and I do need to trim down these sides a little bit, so I should go ahead and shave them kind of square for now. Basically take the flare out of them, in other words, and that fits on there pretty goddamn good. Hopefully I don't pop the camera. You see, it's sitting in there, so we're good, we're groovy. I'm gonna go ahead and test this wedge over here on a flat surface, and I'll be right back. And like I said, all I'm doing is holding this in my left hand. I'm gonna drop that on the ground, hold it flat, and just see how close we are to levelness and all that. And this actually looks pretty spot on. So when I'm holding it, it's laying flat depending on where my hand position is on the end over there. Get back so you can see my ugly mug. And just teeter-tottering towards kind of picking it up. If I bring my hand in, if I bring my hand out, it's kind of slacking off. So I'm gonna guesstimate that that's pretty close. And we're just gonna pop this sucker on here. And then I'm going to secure it. I mean, as you can see, it's on there, just tightening this up, it's on there pretty darn tight, but there's a little hole here where I pulled that rivet out, and I'm basically going to put a little drill mark in there with a small drill, and then I'm going to set a wood screw in there to just kind of tighten it up. I just need to get something that's an inch and a half or less, so I'm going to have to dig around to find something appropriate. And I do kind of want to square this end up a little more. So I think what I'm going to do is just hit that with a saw instead of this to make a slightly more precise cut. So I'll be right back. Okie dokie. So what I have here is just your basic bottom of the line handsaw that you can pick up from any hardware store. I'm pretty sure they're all made in China. I'm pretty sure they get all their blades from Alibaba, so all these hardware stores probably just order these in bulk and have them brand their little logo on there. It's not an expensive tool. I don't know the exact price, but I think I probably got it for about 10 or 15 bucks, knowing myself. So what I'm going to do is, so here's a pointer. Whenever you're cutting with a handsaw, these are designed to be really, really accurate tools if you use them right. If you don't use them right, then I guess you're going to have problems. But if you need a really straight cut like this, I'm just going to do it by hand. I'm not going to like level it out and measure it. But you can take a ruler or a straight end of a stick or something if you want to get a really precise cut. And you can lay that on there roughly where you want your cut to be. And you can clamp that or just hold it with your hand. Just make sure your fingers are away from the cutting edge. And then you can back the saw against that piece of wood or that thing, and just go really, really lightly like this until it starts to dig and bite, and you will have a pretty darn straight little cut to go off of. You can even, I don't recommend it, but if you chop a lot of vegetables in the kitchen, you use your knuckles kind of with your chopping knife, you can do the same thing with the saw blade to kind of hold it in place and guide it while you're making your starting cut, and then get your hand out of the way and continue on. And once you've got that initial bite, then all you have to do is follow it. And I've actually used this to rip boards before, this technique. I basically take my level, which is almost a meter long, lay it on top of a short board, and then just clamp it down and run the saw just real gentle all the way up and down it to the end, and then once I've got my line cut, then I can take it, unclamp it, and I can just go down with the saw and cut, like, basically rip a board perfectly straight with a handsaw. So that little technique has some advantages. The other thing you want to do is be behind the saw, and for lack of a better description, just let the saw do the cutting. You know, you don't have to be forceful with it. Now, for whatever reason, this walnut's biting. And I don't know why it's biting the saw blade, but it is. And it's frustrating, annoying, but probably because it's wet. And so all these little chips are making it retain water and want to swell because it's green wood. But we'll just see what we can do here. So, and then your arm should be basically in line with the saw too when you're using it. And that is just not really working out so well, so I'm gonna come here on an angle and just kind of start me a new cut like this. I don't know why that's grabbing so much. I really don't. It's just like as soon as I cut it, it started to collapse closed. It's weird. Oh, come on, don't make a liar out of me. I don't want to get the damn. I've seen wood do this with a circular saw before too. I've never seen it do it with my handsaw. Maybe my little teeth aren't sticking out far enough or something. I don't know. But probably just a case of the wood's wet and it just doesn't want to saw right. But I'm sure we'll still get through here. Just gonna take a little more time and effort. Come on. Nice and easy, big guy. Nice and easy. That is adding quite a bit of... Oh, I know why it's doing it. Dumb, because I'm leaning down on this. That's probably one reason. Let's go ahead and get it over here off to the side. And try it over here like this. Maybe it'll cut a little better. Oh, yeah, that's a little better. Oop. Them fingers out the way. Gash my hand open on TV. Come on, saw. Just cut nice and easy, bud. This piece of wood just don't want to cut. It's part of what this is. I know what the deal is. Staple there for me, please. Alrighty. And the other part of it is I don't have it braced with anything, so. Alright, now I'm sure some woodworkers watching me and going, God, what a moron. But you know what? I don't care. Come on. Yeah, I probably should have braced this on something. But it just doesn't want to cut this soft wood for some reason. And I'm not sure why. Let's just go ahead and break that piece out. And then we'll try and get the rest of this guy down just nice and easy on the cut line. So... I don't know what your theory is on that. My theory is wet wood. Which in reality, I really shouldn't be fitting this on a wet piece of wood. I should let this season a little bit. But like I said, I just want to get something cutting and something going. And this is a test. So, it's only a test. Now we can put this on here. Nice, flat, and even. And we'll just pop that sucker on there. And kaboom, look at that, tasty sauce. Nice little dark walnut interior. And that looks like it'll work. So like I said, I'm basically just gonna pop a little wood screw in here, and then that guy's hafted and almost ready to cut. Now I am gonna have to make a handle for this also, so I'm gonna put that on there. And because if I'm choking up on the grip a little bit and I put the handle about here, then I think that's gonna put me right where I'm sitting on the ground. So I'm gonna be wanting to be up in the air a little bit, so I may move down here even a little bit further. And this is not, this is like two fists below the top of my head, which I guess is not ideal according to that guy, but to get my angle right, I'm gonna have to be somewhere in there to get it up sort of off the ground and get it comfortable. I don't want my right lever here, so I need to figure out a way to put another stick onto this that will come up and turn, and I can grab onto it like a handle, and then I can pick this whole thing up off the ground and with light swinging just bring that guy around. I'm also gonna have to drill a hole here through the middle here to get this lined up with this slot, and then that's where that little eye bolt is gonna go to secure everything in place and lock the blade in place and do all the fun things that we need to do. So basically, and that's another reason I'm not worried about this being wet wood. I mean, this was secured to what looks like a piece of driftwood, probably still laying around here somewhere. Yeah, it was secured to this when I bought it, and all that wiggle that you saw in it, that was after I loosened the bolt. So when I picked this up, it was on here securely, and look at this, it's shrunken wood, it's just, it looks horrible, and that thing was still secured to this quite well. So it's basically designed to fit nice and tight, and it does. And somehow I got that angle pretty close, I think, just on accident. So I'm not trying to be too precise with it. We'll just drop a screw in here and then do this piece. So I'm gonna leave the camera running and I can skip ahead later. And I'm gonna go and get my saw and a couple of drill bits and maybe a screw. And then we can figure out what to do with this next. Actually, I'll have to turn the camera off and then come back. Okay, so I'm back. Now I've got this little screw here. It's probably gonna be small enough. It's not gonna come poking out of the other end. Now, as a point of record, I hate these little screws. I use these to attach my the decking for my roof. And I think I dropped more of them on the ground than I actually got in the decking. And it was really, really frustrating. I usually find the longer wood screws like these to just generally cooperate better, but this is soft green wood, so I don't think, hopefully I won't have too many problems. And this is basically just a set screw, kind of. The one thing it does have is a double bevel here, so it's beveled all the way down to the deal. So as long as I get this kind of halfway centered on here, then I don't think we're going to have any problem with it coming out. The thing is, you got to apply a lot of pressure with these and go kind of slow and easy, because they will, the grip on the bite is more solid than the actual screw itself. So it'll spin and it'll tear the wood out instead of sticking. So I'm not going to put a lot of pressure on it. Just gonna drive that puppy in there, and now, aside from this being slammed on nice and tight, that set screw's not moving anywhere, and this joker is just gonna probably hold up for a way longer time than what I need it to. So now comes the fun part, and I don't really have anywhere to set this, so, and I'm not moving the camera because that's a pain, but I'm basically just gonna try and drill a hole straight down in this. And I don't know how big of a hole to drill, so I just brought the whole set. and I'm probably going to be going with this monster, the half inch, but let's see what this thing has to say about it. And it doesn't look like that's a terrible idea. But I basically want to go as big as I can without hanging up on the metal. And this looks like, I don't know, there's definitely a possibility that it could bite into this rusty metal. So, but other than that, it's almost perfect size. Do I want to do that or not? I think I do. I think I want to try a half inch. Come on. And it's not like I don't have a... There's my screwdriver. It's not like I don't have a giant lever to go with here, so... Come on, what the fucker. So, we will pick this guy up, turn him around, try and hold him halfway level and halfway straight. And this guy has basically got to go down like that, which is going to be... Look, Mom, no cavities. That seems to be cutting in there pretty good. I did catch a little bit of the rust, but it basically just deburred it and got the rust off it. Now what I'm looking at is my angle of attack here. If this is level, I've actually got to come in a little bit, so I don't know how I'm going to hit that without screwing it up, but let's try our best and see what happens. Not too shabby. Alright, I guess it is kind of hot out because that was my my camera just like winked at me and then quit working. I don't know what the deal with that is. Anyways, go ahead and set that down so I don't chop my hand off. We got this big monster here, and this goes on the end of the stick, see? Sorry. And then we've got this little monster here, and this holds it on the end of the stick. In theory. So, I'm going to put the big monster down for a minute. I'm going to back this off. And I probably should have grabbed my pliers before I turn the tape back on. So, the little eye goes in the bottom of the shaft here. Okay. And we may need to wedge that out a bit, I would imagine. And that goes on the top of the shaft. And then this thing, let's just turn him around upside down. It goes on here, like it is. Guess I don't need to turn him around too far, do I? And we've already got this kind of angled out, so I'm going to put this in the innermost peg here. And we'll tighten this down a little bit. And it looks like... I may have this bolt in here backwards, I don't know. Anyways. Is the bolt in there backwards? Why are you turning? What are you doing? Yep. And so that's pressed in pretty far. So one thing I'm noticing is my bolt hole is not perfectly square. It seems to be leaning out this way a little bit. So let me grab that drill and I'll see if I can just kind of yank it back this other direction and maybe do something a little bit better with it. Just a second. Stay. Ow.
Yeah. I'm just gonna, so it looks like the hole drifted out this way a little bit, so I'm just gonna try and basically just sort of ream it out a little bit, wiggle it left and right. That'll give that bolt a little more clearance, because I mean, it's just got to sit down in that slot, and then instead of doing this whole thing like that, it might be safer to just do them like this. And we want them in the innie or in the outie. We've already got this kind of outie, so we'll put them in the outie. Come on. Watch as I slice my finger off, and you can see what this is doing. This is basically, depending on which of these pegs you put this in, it kind of angles the blade differently. And since I have no idea what the hell I'm doing, we do it like that, and that's going to be a little too far in, I think. I mean, I'm not an expert, but that almost looks like it's way too far in, even if we line it up from here. So we'll just do it in this one. And then bring it in as needed, because if it doesn't work in this one, it ain't going to work in none of them. Alright, and then I'll go ahead and get my little bolt secured on here. Try not to pop myself in the eye. Alright, and that's loosey-goosey, okay? Loose as nuts, and that's why we need a thing. But for now, looking at this, just pop that on the ground real quick and get over here and do my stand here and hold it and look pretty dense. And we overheated the battery again. So I'm about to hang that part up, but I went ahead and tightened this guy on here. Tell you what, this is probably the coolest thing in the world. Okay, maybe not the coolest thing in the world, but it's pretty awesome, and it's pretty sweet that it went together that fast, and it's pretty great that it works as well as it does. So even without handles, I went and cut me a little swath over here, went and cut a little swath over there, and it's obvious that handles would make it different, because without it, a handle on here, your hands are kind of orienting themselves in a way, and you're trying to control the twist, so that's forearm muscles, tension back and forth. You're trying to control your swing, and the entire time you're doing this, your arms are bent, basically. So, not a good way to do things. So after fiddling with it for a little bit, though, it's good because it gives you an idea like what the handles need to accomplish, and sort of where they need to be to make this work better. And I've already got an idea. Like this one, I could probably hold straight the way my hand hold is, but when my body turns, then it's angling the blade in, so I'm going to have to figure that out a little bit, because it goes from a nice slicing good action to just pretty much running parallel with the grass and skipping it, and just not even worrying about it. So you end up cutting really nice and smooth on the right, and then so there's something to be said for technique also, which I'm going to have to learn and read and figure out. But the fact that this works at all in its current state, I think says something as to the functionality and usability of the tool. So once I figure out where I want my handles, what I'm going to make them out of, and how to get them on here, I mean, I'm thinking just putting one handle on it for now down here, and maybe just attaching a strip of plywood to come up and then have the handle come off of that plywood, but that's not going to be very sturdy. So I'm going to have to do some thinking on that, maybe find a good little just L-shaped piece of wood and then put it on there with a solid wood screw, something like that, and figure out where I want it. But totally works, totally, even with this I mean, this is just a rough edge that I filed on it real quick, trying to follow this bevel where the bevel is, because I recognize this same kind of things on my straight razors to line up the bevel, and somebody had done a sharpening job on here where they weren't following that line, and that's pretty obvious and apparent. So I'm gonna have to go around putting that bevel back on probably, so I may want to learn how to do it properly, or I may just wing it like I do a whole bunch of stuff. But either way, this is definitely a pretty badass tool, and you know, if you want to harvest some souls, I'm sure it works just fine for that. But for us, harvesting hay is going to be the goal. So let me see if I can get some handles on here. I may or may not end the video right here. I'm not sure yet. But if I can find some handles laying around here today before the day's out, something that I can use as a handle, and just throw it on here real quick, and then maybe get some slicing footage or something, that'd make for a good video. Yes, absolutely loving this. I think this is probably one of the coolest little jobs I've done so far, because I didn't wake up this morning expecting that I was going to end the day with a $5 scythe. Yeah, $5 for this piece of metal here, this piece of metal here, some filing, a branch from the woods, and boom, you got a mowing tool for $5, and a couple of screws, and a little bit of time. So, it's pretty awesome. Awesome sauce. Anyways, I'm going to get back at it, and then if I make any more progress on it, I'll go ahead and update the video. If this is the end of the video, then don't forget to subscribe and tell your friends to check out my channel and have them subscribe to it, and yeah, stay on it. Keep up. Keep in touch. Leave comments. All that kind of fun stuff. Trying to get everything lined up. That is loosey-goosey. So I'm going to have to add some kind of support bracing here on the side to keep it, but it's definitely holding the weight. And for the moment, I think that's gonna work for now. I need to add a little more bracing. I'm thinking I'm just gonna get two little chips, like, I don't know, like this maybe, and put one on either side of the handle and just secure it with some little screws. Or I might even just grab a piece of plywood from over there and do the same thing with that, just to kind of shore it up, because it's left and right. Basically, this handle is acting like a sort of lever. So it is, and I mean, I should have like flattened this somehow or cut a bevel into this or something, but that just looked like it was going to be a lot of work. And these are screws. I can always undo them whenever I feel like it. But yeah, definitely something there to keep this from turning side to side, because there's nothing to stop that lateral motion. And one thing, the reason I put the handle on this side versus this side is when I was experimenting, you've got the weight of the blade is placed on this hand. So if you've got it, the handle on this side, and you pick it up, it's going to want to dip down. So with the handle on this side, when you pick it up, it automatically kind of rights that blade. And where I'm holding it is actually, I'll probably have to experiment around a little bit, but where I'm holding it has got it where it's pretty much balanced right there on that point. And the handle's long enough that if I pull a heavier blade, you know, I'll have to come out here. But if I do it this way, it's going to tip up. If I do it this way, it's going to tip down. So you just kind of get your handhold where you need it to make sure that that blade is level with the ground. And that seems to be working for me. I'm not sure if that's right or correct or any kind of accurate representation at all, but I know what I see, and from what I see, this seems to be working pretty good. And just figured I'd cut a little patch over there to kind of show you how it works. It's not like you're not grabbing and dragging and hacking. It's just a smooth, like, slicing motion. Once I get my technique sort of figured out, then all I'll need to do is basically just twist my body and dance across the field, so to speak, and get the grass cut. And it seems like it's gonna work really good for that. Not bad for $5. Alrighty, that will officially end the video, because all the rest of this stuff, I mean, I'm sure you can figure out how to make a brace. It's two screws and a block of wood. It's not exactly complicated. And I'm just bracing it side to side, and that's gonna shore it up on angle wise too. So a couple small screws and a little bit more working, and this will be done, like, today. I just got to go find two small screws and plop them in there, basically, and then we're done. So, yep, I'm going to cut it off there. Find me a good-sized chunk of wood, drive two screws, and this joker will be done. Bye. Hope you enjoyed it.